Hello, statisticians. Mr. Youngsaver here from Skew the Script. Today we're going to talk about a complex topic, trying to quantify intelligence using data. We're going to investigate using the normal curve and the empirical rule. Let's skew it. Today's lesson's on the empirical rule. This is lesson 2.3 in our course sequence. Now, before we jump fully into the topic of intelligence testing, it's important to learn a little bit about the history of IQ tests and how they've been used and misused in the past. The first modern intelligence test was developed by two psychologists in France. They called it the Binet-Simon IQ test, and it was the first widely used intelligence test in the world. In 1917, a group of American psychologists brought this test to the United States, and they used it on Europeans immigrating to the US through Ellis Island. Here is a table of their peculiar results from their original report. I call them peculiar for this reason. They found that 83% of Jews, 80% of Hungarians, 79% of Italians, and 87% of Russians immigrating to the US were quote unquote feeble-minded, according to their IQ tests. And these proportions were found to be quote unquote morons. Now, the authors had some mixed reactions to this, but they come to this conclusion eventually. One can hardly escape the conviction that the intelligence of the average quote unquote third class immigrant is low, perhaps of moron grade. Now, I'm a bit skeptical of these results, maybe partly because I'm a descendant of one of those mostly moron grade Jews who immigrated to the United States in the early 1900s. I also happen to know these facts and figures. Today, Jews make up 3% of the US population, 0.2% of the world population, yet they make up 36% of US Nobel Prize winners and 20% of all Nobel Prize winners across the world, 23% of Fields Medals winners, and about 16% of Ivy League students at schools like Harvard, Yale, et cetera. So on these traditional metrics of academic quote unquote intelligence, there seems to be some overrepresentation of people from that descent who they found to be mostly moron grade. Now, most people discredit these results because they find that rather than describing differences in true intelligence, most people think that this was differences in language, culture, and education. And so the people taking these tests were not given a fair shot at doing well on them. However, today, IQ tests are still widely used, and modern tests claim they have more validity than their older counterparts. One of the proponents of IQ tests were the authors of this book, The Bell Curve. It was published in 1994. It was a New York Times bestseller when it was released, and it analyzes data from a more modern, and they claim more valid, IQ test. And they arrived at a controversial result. There appeared to be racial differences in IQ tests among tested Americans. So for today's key analysis, we're going to ask, are there true racial ethnic differences in intelligence, or might there be something else going on? If you'd like to follow along, you can print up guided notes at this URL. So first, let's talk about the normal curve. So the normal curve is a distribution of data that is symmetric and bell-shaped. And because it's symmetric, the mean equals the median, and both are located at the exact center of the data set. Now, most claim that IQ scores are normal. IQ stands for the quote-unquote intelligence quotient. It's a measure of intelligence, and it's widely believed to be normally distributed in the population. Most people have IQ scores that are close to this mean of 100 points with some variations. So some people have higher IQ scores, some people have lower, and very few people are going to have very high or very low IQ scores. And most believe that IQ has a standard deviation in the population of about 15 points. So let's talk about the empirical rule. So the empirical rule states that this distribution has a specific share within standard deviations of the mean. Within one standard deviation of the mean, you'll find 68% of the data in a normal curve. So if you go one standard deviation above the mean, one standard deviation below, and you find the amount of data within those bounds, you'll find that 68% of the data exists there. If you go two standard deviations out, so in this case, going from the IQ scores of 70 to 130, you'll find that 95% of the data is there. So in theory, 95% of people have IQ scores between 70 and 130, which is two standard deviations above and below the mean of 100. And then if you go three standard deviations out, you're really getting out into the tails, you'll find 99.7% of the data within those bounds. Now, recall in our previous lesson on Z-scores, Michael Jordan's points per game was 3.6 standard deviations above the mean. So if the distribution of points per game is normal, you can see how unusually high of a score Michael Jordan was for his era. And so that gives you some way of quantifying how unusual a z-score might be if this distribution is normal. So let's talk through an example of how you might use the empirical rule to come up with proportions from a normal curve. So assume IQ is normally distributed with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15 points. What percent of test takers score at least 70 points? So a strategy you should use for normal curve problems is to, one, draw and label. It's probably the most essential thing. Draw it out, label it, include the mean, standard deviation, tick marks, and shading to really conceptualize what's happening in the problem. Perform your calculations while showing work, and then answer the question with context. AP grade is going to be looking for all these things. So what percent of test takers score at least 70 points? Well, first note that I've drawn and labeled this normal curve. I've labeled the distribution. We go as a normal with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. I've drawn that bell shape centered at 100 with tick marks for the standard deviations, and I've labeled it as IQ scores. Now, I want to find the percent that score at least 70 points. So at least means that the least score, the lowest score they can have, is 70. So I'm going to draw a line at 70 IQ. I'm going to shade everything above it, because if their least score is 70, that means 70 and above, 70 and higher. We're at least at 70, so that means we can have 70 or more. And what we want to find is the percent covered within that area that I drew. So one thing I might note is that 70 is two standard deviations below the mean. Recall the standard deviation was 15 points. So if we go from 100 down 15 points, that's 85, down 15 points again, that's 70. We've gone two standard deviations down. And so I know that within two standard deviations of the mean, we have 95% of our data. So we have 95% of the data, at least in this curve right now. But here's the thing, I need that tail as well, because I need to get everything above 70, including beyond two standard deviations above the mean. So one thing I do know is that if 95% is within two standard deviations of the mean, that means that 5% is in the tails. 5% is out there in the tails. 100 minus 95 is 5. So I know that the normal curve is symmetric. And so if I'm just trying to get one tail rather than both, we just do 5 divided by 2, you get 2.5%. So 2.5% of the data is within that tail up there on the right. And so if I take the 95% I had before, add the 2.5% in the tail, I see that we have 97.5%. So this means that 97.5% of test takers score at least a 70 on an IQ test. Now, let's go through another example. What IQ test score is at the 84th percentile? So I'm gonna go ahead and draw and label my normal curve once again. We need to make sure we always do that. And I know that the word percentile means the percent that are at or below a certain value. So I know that 84% of test takers are at or below a certain IQ that I'm looking for. So I can go ahead and draw that on the graph. It's going to be somewhere on the right side of that curve, because 84% of the data is below it. So it should be on the right somewhere. And one way to break this down first is to see, okay, well, at 100, at the mean, we know that I'm already at the 50th percentile. 50% of the data is going to be below that mean. So that takes out a 50% chunk from that 84% that I'm looking for. That leaves over about 34% that we haven't covered yet. Now, one thing to remember is that 68% of the data in a normal curve is within one standard deviation of the mean. And if you divide 68 by 2, if you split it in half, you get 34%. So this is really, if you think about it, the percent of data that's from the mean to that first standard deviation above. So if we can split this up into 50-34, we know that we need to go one more standard deviation above that mean to capture 34% of the data. And so now I have my overall 84%. So I'm combining the 50 and 34 to make that 84. So if we go one standard deviation above the mean, that means 15 points, the standard deviation above the mean of 100. An IQ score of 115 is at the 84th percentile. And the distribution is above 84% of IQ scores. So that brings us to our discussion question for today. As I mentioned at the top of the video, there was a book published called The Bell Curve in 1994. It was a New York Times bestseller when it came out, and it analyzes data from a more modern, normally distributed IQ test. Hence, the book called itself The Bell Curve and put a normal curve on its front cover. The authors found some controversial results. They found that Black people score about one standard deviation, 15 points lower on IQ tests compared to white people on average. And to this day, commentators use this result as evidence of racial differences in intelligence. Now, because of the controversial nature of this result, We might want to dismiss it entirely, but at the same time, we can't dismiss results just because we don't like them. We need to investigate them further as statisticians and data scientists. So let's do that. The IQ test they use was known as the Air Force Qualifying Test. And in 1980, the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth had over 10,000 teachers take that test. It's a test developed by the Air Force to evaluate new recruits to the forces. And these scores were analyzed as IQ scores by the bell curve. Now, the bell curve authors claim that the AFQT qualifies not just as an IQ test, but as one of the better ones psychometrically. So not only is it an IQ test, it's one of the most valid instruments out there. The AFQT was divided at the time into four parts: arithmetic reasoning, word knowledge, paragraph comprehension, and mathematics knowledge. Now let's look at some simulated problems from a couple of these sections. So here's a simulated problem from the word knowledge section. Solitary most nearly means A, sunny, B, being alone, C, playing games, D, soulful. And here's a simulated question from the math knowledge section. In the drawing below, JK is the median of the trapezoid. All the following are true except, and they give you four statements to choose from. So here's a couple of sample questions from the test. And I want you to think about these discussion questions before you come into class. Do you believe that the AFQT accurately measures intelligence? Why or why not? And B, building on your answer from that first part, what might explain the racial differences found in the bell curve? One additional optional extension question to think about before you go into class: do you believe it's possible at all to design a test that accurately measures a person's innate intelligence? Why or why not? That's it for today, statisticians. We'll see you in class.